So as we convene our first panel of the day, our focus is on interdisciplinary approaches to cybersecurity, a major theme of our day, to show, as I mentioned in my remarks earlier, it takes a village, and there's a great number of opportunities. And our next panel really features that diversity. We have lawyers and engineers and strategists and folks with expertise in many different parts of cybersecurity, as you'll hear. So I want to start by introducing our moderator, Nicole Friedlander, who will give you a little bit of her background, the background on all of our panelists, and then we'll get into the conversation. Thank you.
Thanks, Judy. I'm not sure if my mic is working. Do you know how to turn this on? I don't. Hi, good morning, everyone. As Judy mentioned, my name is Nicole Friedlander. I'm a lawyer at Sullivan and Cromwell and a member of the firm's cybersecurity group. Until recently, I worked at the U.S. Attorney's Office in Manhattan, where I was the chief of the Complex Frauds and Cybercrime Unit. It's great to be here at NYU Law, where I got my law degree 15 years ago. I think few of us imagined then that cybercrime would become such a huge threat, much less the existential threat, an existential threat for our country. Fortunately, we adapt, and today our institutions, like this terrific university, lead cybersecurity research efforts, and some of our most talented and accomplished leaders, like the women on this panel today, are devoting their careers to protecting our networks and our national security. So let me introduce them. First to my left is Merritt Baer. Merritt works in the Department of Homeland Security's Cybersecurity and Communications Unit. There, she helps to coordinate the government's national response to cyber incidents. Merritt is also a founding partner at the business accelerator coVenturr and an adjunct professor of cybersecurity at the University of Maryland. Merritt is a lawyer by training and graduated from Harvard Law School. Patricia Goforth is an executive vice president at Booz Allen Hamilton, the management and technology consulting firm. She leads the firm's cyber operations business. Trish and her team of thousands of cybersecurity professionals play a significant role in protecting and strengthening the networks of the United States government. Trish is a systems engineer by training with BS and MS degrees in systems engineering from the University of Virginia. Melody Hildebrandt is the global head of cybersecurity at Palantir Technologies, a software and technology services company that has become a major provider of sophisticated data analysis tools across the public and private sectors. Prior to working at Palantir, where she helped found the New York office, Melody worked at Booz Allen Hamilton, where she designed cyber war games and simulations for the US government. Melody received a BA in economics from Tufts University. Finally, at the end of the table is Kim Peretti, a partner at Alston & Byrd, the national law firm, and co-chair of the firm's Cybersecurity Preparedness and Response Team. Kim counsels corporate clients in cybersecurity preparedness and security incident response. Kim is the former director of PricewaterhouseCoopers Cyber Forensics Group, and before that, she was a leading computer crimes prosecutor in the Department of Justice. There, she led the successful prosecution of Albert Gonzalez, an American hacker who stole over 134 million credit cards in one of the largest, if not the largest, credit card breach ever. Kim received her law degree from Georgetown University. It's a pleasure to have you here with us today. So let me begin by noting that you are all leaders in the field of cybersecurity, but your jobs and areas of focus are quite different. For that reason, I'd like to start by asking each of you to answer two questions. First, can you tell us about your career path? What brought you to where you are today? And second, what is the cybersecurity issue or area that you are most focused on right now? And Merritt, perhaps we could start with you.
Thank you so much. Thanks, Nicole, and thank you for being here, everyone. So, it's really hard for me to answer questions that I think are self-evident, where I feel like, doesn't everyone think this is interesting? Doesn't everyone think this is the world? These are the questions. That being said, the career path is hard. I think when I was graduating from law school, and even during law school, I was making up my own studies, saying, would you pay me $11 an hour to look up this question? There was part of me that thought, am I crazy? And part of me that knew that I was right. And I think follow that bone is advice number one. Advice number two is sort of like, chase people who believe in you, because you will always need other people to also help you. And it's often old white dudes in this field. So I didn't give a disclaimer that this is not DHS, but this is just the truth. So you will need people to promote you, to be your champion. And I think that is just the fact in the world of pretty much any career path. But this one in particular attracts people who are smart, and then it burns them because they don't fit. And I think my call to arms would be, the water is warm. Coding is like this whole wild, wild west, aside from the racist crap that that means, is not true. Code either runs or it doesn't. Get in, the water is warm. If you are an architect or an artist or someone who just believes that this country could be better, if you're an innovator in whatever field, we need you. Come work for DHS is sort of my sly pitch. But like, you can wear jeans, but I just think that, literally, we changed that policy. It's silly, but it matters. I think that it's exciting. I think that I could tell you about my path here, which involved me working for young companies, involved me writing and publishing and creating my own network. And I think I would advise folks to do that. Not that I have been perfect, but more that I have been following my nose. And I would very much encourage everyone to sort of carve out a narrative to figure out what you're good at, and also figure out what makes sense given the landscape. So if you care a lot about education, if you care a lot about environment, if you care a lot about medical issues, if you care about poverty, if you care about cities, I mean, these are human issues. And these are internet issues, and these are cybersecurity issues. So I know it can feel like Clash of the Titans with companies against companies, but frankly, at DHS, I work with companies all the time, and the private sector owns and operates the infrastructure. And it's exciting, and it is driven by known forces that are really human and relatable. And I think these are ways that you absolutely can and should contribute, and I would say my one thing that I wanted to get out first was just a sort of call to arms.
Trish?
Okay. So coming out of engineering school at University of Virginia, my first job was working for a large aerospace company, designing satellite communication systems that would allow our command and control leaders to operate through a nuclear war. It was sort of toward the tail end of the Cold War era. As we came out of that, DoD had to start utilizing more of commercial capabilities and internet and such. And so I changed my focus to working with some of the information system providers within the DoD, how to adopt these commercial technologies. And then obviously, when you're using common infrastructure for defense purposes, security is an important aspect. So we began, really making sure that security engineering was embedded in all the design work that we were doing. And then Booz Allen doesn't really have a formal executive development program. Most of our training is by taking on different roles across the firm. And 3 years ago, I was asked to transition from the engineering role to moving up to Fort Meade area and working in our cyber operations group. And this is a big change for me because I have done engineering all of my career. And now I was being asked to provide services that support our operational commanders, including General Buckner, and how to use those technologies that were developed, and also how to train its workforce. And so those are the two areas that are my current area of focus, is always looking out in industry to figure out what technologies can be integrated into the operational area. And also within, for folks who are looking to develop their careers in the cyberspace, we're doing it for Booz Allen, as we has been mentioned several times this morning. There are many disciplinary approaches that you can develop your career around cyber. So we want to lay out the career framework and training programs that allow people to flourish in those. And then we're doing similar consulting for our clients to help them do the same thing so that they have a trained workforce.
Melody?
Great. So I guess my path kind of started as being a board game geek and then finding a way to actually do that for a living by designing war games for the U.S. government. And essentially that background, I think, then transitioned to Palantir, which is a technology company, and one of our clients was hacked, and I guess the thing that was, the skill that I had that was useful was like I could operate pretty well in a crisis, which is what it was for us, since it was before we had any kind of cybersecurity business. And from there, like really, I just being like thrust into that crisis and realizing kind of what it took to actually, this is a large bank at the time, like provider of services to millions of Americans and around the world, what it meant to actually be able to bring that company back online and be able to deliver these services was a pretty exciting challenge and was really kind of what opened me and brought me into cyber, and then built our cyber business from there, given that opportunity. I think the second part of the question, like what I'm working on and excited about, I think the starting in the commercial space, obviously we see the impacts of hacking and to large institutions. I've been pretty interested more recently, and even just thinking about like what the impact is of all these breaches on like on the consumer side, from even like what is the like perception of digital identity now in the future, in a post-breach world? Like, what does it mean to be someone when all of your personal identifiable information has probably been exposed? And what does that mean for how you authenticate and how you prove who you are and how you are able to operate just as a consumer in the world, as opposed to, like, from the position of a bank? Like, it was sad the bank was hacked for them. But like, all of us are now really impacted, any of us who utilize services and have to authenticate who we are to bank or to do anything else. So this is, I think, the issue that I've been really interested in, and like kind of working with our clients and thinking through, how do they validate identity? How do they know who you are? And one of the many exciting things about the field, but one area in particular that I'm focused on.
Good morning, everyone. I want to thank Judy Germano for inviting me to be here. I'm very much honored to participate in this event today. So 20 years I went through law school with one purpose in mind. I'm very interested in corporate governance
and securities law, and spent three years strategically every step trying to focus on that. Graduated, went over to Germany and got an LLM in German corporate securities law, analyzing takeover markets, and that's where my career was headed. Came back to the United States the first day I started practicing law. I strategically went with a law firm to work with a German partner, work with a German bank. After working with a German bank in Germany, he sat down with me and on a napkin outlined this encryption algorithm and how we were going to have banks engage in secure electronic commerce. And pretty much then I just tossed all this other stuff aside and spent the past 20 years have been devoted to understanding technology and its legal implications. But I got involved in information, cyber before cyber was cool, engaged in information security, and even thought about leaving law and did for a while. Got a CISSP, a certification, focused on information security issues, and touched upon law, but went out on my own for a little bit after a couple years at a law firm, more on the consulting side. Met some people at DOJ, and they said, why don't you come over? We've got a cybercrime unit. I'm like, well, prosecution, cyber, criminal issues, I have no background in it. But started that and fell in love. It was right when we saw the first cases of online crime. And then it was called, internet sites with tens of thousands of members trading stolen financial information. We worked on some of the first benchmark undercover investigations to understand online crime. So I spent 8 years doing that. And most of it really was less in court and more with the investigation side, working with the FBI and the Secret Service, because Once we caught them, if we ever did catch the criminals, they usually pled guilty pretty quickly. That wasn't the fun part. The fun part was catching them if we could and working on new legal processes in order to engage, enable our law enforcement to take upon the challenges of finding, you know, these criminals and putting them to justice. So after all those years of investigating, I moved over. I didn't think the legal environment would support solely a cyber legal practice. So I went to a consulting firm, to PwC, to lead armies of cyber warriors called upon to help out companies respond to pretty sophisticated cyber breaches, and enjoyed doing that until very recently the cybersecurity legal market has blossomed, and now we have something called cybersecurity law. So I moved back over into the legal area to help advise clients on cybersecurity preparedness issues, how to prepare for being attacked, how to prepare your company, how to mitigate cyber risk, and also how to help companies respond to any number of security incidents and data breaches. And I would say 90% of my time, although I try to get that down to a smaller percentage, 90% of my time or more is firefighting. Every day, a new incident, related to sophisticated threat actors from abroad or ransomware or poor employee, HR employee, 25 years with the company, clicked on a button and sent the whole payroll database out to a Russian hacker. It's daily and it's sad, and there's a lot of work we need to do, but it is encouraging at how far we've come in just a short period of time.
Thank you. I'd like to talk about the cyber threat and to hear your perspectives on the threat, because you bring such different perspectives to bear on cybersecurity. So let me address the first question to Melody and Patricia. Federal law enforcement and intelligence agencies rely on you for cybersecurity defense. What, in your view, is the greatest threat that they currently face?
Kick off. There's two things that are interesting. I think the general really spoke quite eloquently about the national security implications. I think speaking more maybe on the civilian side, what you see with the government and most recent hacks of the government is really massive concentration of information about citizens of the country and employees of the U.S. government. Potentially, one could argue that the government has not necessarily guarded that trove of information with the right precautions. Think about like the IRS hack and then the millions of Americans' tax information that was exposed, OPM hack, millions of cleared government employees' information being exposed. So I think that when I think about one of the big risks to the U.S. government now is really the concentration of information around individuals that is potentially can be exploited. And then what allows that to be exploited, and I think is really the challenge, is really just the complexity of government systems and how the government is often running highly just bespoke environments that are unique to them, as opposed to necessarily running commercial best practices in terms of the environments themselves. And so the complexity of the environments is really what introduces the opportunity for exploitation, and the fact that there's so much diversity across these environments is actually very hard to be able to push improvements to them. It's not like Microsoft can push automatic update and impact millions of improve the security of millions of people who run Microsoft products. There isn't that same ability to introduce defense at scale in the U.S. government. I think given that each of the agencies and offices are running highly bespoke architectures that don't allow that kind of scaled defense. And that's creating real opportunity, I think, for exploitation. And then the data that's behind the scenes, obviously, is quite valuable.
Yeah, so exactly. The value of the data that's on the government networks is extremely high for criminal and espionage purposes. So there's continual demand to try and get at it. And we're sort of in this vicious cycle, right, that technology keeps evolving. So many great opportunities for productivity and for us to use the technology for security, but at the same time, the bad guys are using the technology to increase their capabilities. As we continue to adopt new technologies, that increases the attack surface. And so it's just, again, it's sort of a vicious cycle. And the threat actors are also now working together in dark web kind of spaces to share best practices. There's even, you know, ransomware as a service. There's cyber expertise as a service. So folks, nations who were perhaps lagging in their cyber capabilities now can leap ahead into their capabilities by taking advantage of such forums. So as they continue to advance, we have to continue to advance. We have to continue to advance, again, through the integration of technologies and keeping our cybersecurity professionals ahead of that threat.
And Merritt, how do you see this from the Homeland Security perspective? What are the biggest threats, or what's the biggest threat that the government is facing?
So, I mean, I think you just have to assume your information is out there. It's for purchase, it's 50 cents on the dark web. Like, get over that. This whole marquee about how the sky is falling just to me doesn't resonate. And I'm someone who absolutely would be a target. To me, that's not the point. Like, we interact with tech in a way that every interaction is a transaction. So everyone else on this panel is working for a company that has a bottom line, and they are accountable to their shareholders, and that is a fact in the landscape. In the landscape of government, we have the FBI and other law enforcement agencies who want to catch the bad guy. We've got Intel, which are NSA mostly, but others, who want to collect intelligence and operate covert operations. And spying has been around since before the internet. And now that the internet is here, it's still happening. And you have actually a new landscape, which is the fact that we're transacting our banking, our voting, our dating, our conversations with our mother-in-law online. And that is, to me, new. And so I know that DHS sounds old, but actually, I think in this landscape, it is new because it is the firefighters for the people. I mean, this is your community. And so keeping the lights on is our job, and we do. We are US CERT, we are ICS CERT. ICS stands for Industrial Control Systems. So in terms of emerging threats, sure, you could say cloud, mobile, ICS, IoT. But those are also the ways that we're transacting in so exciting ways. Like, blockchain is scary for all the reasons that it's also secure. It's so cool that we are innovating in ways that allow us to change the way the dynamics between government, people, and citizen, consumer, and company. But they're being defined. So I guess I would say, I'm just not a, I'm not a scare tactic person. I don't think it's scary, I think it's exciting. And I think that there are obviously threats. And, you know, I say this being well aware that there may be trolls who will like dox me tonight and send pizzas to my house. But I just think that it's not worth it to live as a person who's in fear. And I think that technology is in some ways still living up to its promise to enable us and to create new avenues for information. And I still believe in that.
It's nice to hear the glass half full in cybersecurity. We don't hear that very often. Kim, can you tell us about the private sector? What do you think are the biggest threats there?
Sure. So I tend to think of threats in terms of exploitation, continuum. Exploitation to disruption to destruction. And I think we're still in sort of box one as far as biggest threats for the private sector. For most companies, that is, that they are still at risk because they have data. They're at risk of that data being stolen, either by insiders or by external hackers for financial gain, for the most part. And the stealing of that data can cause significant legal exposure, particularly because of the state laws that we have drafted and some federal laws. So that's usually, I would say that's often the biggest threat for companies is someone going to get in, is going to steal my credit card information or my usernames or passwords or even, you know, non-sensitive data, and somehow that's going to get out because it gets media attraction, and then you've got all kinds of issues that follow, including lawsuits and other legal ramifications. So that's one bucket. But I think, and companies are, you know, we sort of have had blinders on because of the legal infrastructure that we have focusing on data breaches. But data breaches isn't all we need to be concerned with. And these recent spate of ransomware that locks systems and locks data all of a sudden is opening companies' eyes up. Wait, there's an operational impact to cybercrime? Systems can shut down. They can be disrupted. I may not be able to deliver on my contracts. Oh, my gosh, what do I do about that? What does that mean? So we don't have as many attackers interested in those buckets yet, the disruption and then ultimately the destruction, but we're moving closer to that, and we've seen more and more of that activity, at least from the state-sponsored actors. So it's an emerging threat, one that we're going to need to ensure our private sector is prepared for. We need to get out of just the data breach bucket and into the operational impact that security incidents can have.
And I want to follow up on your point about the private sector's growing awareness of the operational impact of cyber and cyber events. So we often talk in cybersecurity about the importance of having a plan in place to deal with a breach. But what does that mean in practice? And maybe I'll start with the consulting folks, Melody and Patricia. When you're helping a company plan for the possibility of a breach, what are the first steps? You know, what are you most focused on?
First, you have to take a look at, again, what is your infrastructure, what is your data, and what is the most important from a business perspective that absolutely has to be protected. Because as General Buckner said, you never can be 100% secure, so you have to make the investment decisions, you know, based on the precious jewels. And so making those investment decisions based on priorities and figuring out how you, from there, manage the risk of the breach. And then you have to plan for the fact that you will be breached. And so what are the processes that you will execute when you are breached? As Melody said, the war games have been proven to be a very effective way of simulating a situation like that, figuring out how the different organizational elements will work together, who's responsible for what. And it often, when you walk through simulated scenarios like that, very typically will identify gaps either in your training, in your planning, in your processes, you know, so that you are better prepared when a breach actually does occur.
Yeah, I agree. It's largely going to be a question of risk management and what risk are you willing to take on, and are you actually aware of that risk? I think there is a misconception that, like, you know, that breaches, there's such a wide spectrum of breaches, it's so complex you couldn't possibly kind of enumerate and fully the ways in which a hacker could enter and thus the way that you can defend yourself. Whereas if you look at all the breaches, like, there are a common set of things that happen. You know, like, a bad guy needs to get on your network, they need to move to find the thing that matters, and they need to then, like, exploit something to be able to take that data off the network. So there is that common path that emerges, and so then you can begin to think about asking kind of key questions to say, like, do you actually understand, do you understand your network, and do you understand where that data sits, do you understand who has access to it, do you understand what systems are being running on your network, and what we find is that often is that organizations can't answer those basic questions, and it's kind of this very unsexy question. Sometimes I make the analogy to, like, hygiene in a way, where it's actually, like, the most important thing is probably, like, very basic hygiene measures to be able to reduce the complexity of the network, not be running Windows XP Service Pack 10 like the OPM was, like, these basic things that you should be doing to be able to increase the security of your network so you're not easily exploited. And you can accept that risk knowingly. So I think, I mean, back to the first the point about, like, complexity of government systems, I think similar in the private sector, it's like reducing complexity is really the most important thing, I think, up front, so that organizations actually have some transparency, some window into, like, what is their network, what is the bounds of their network, where are things, and then you can begin to take steps to defend it.
And Kim, from the legal perspective, how do you advise clients in cyber preparedness?
I'm just going to cover two aspects, I think, because I want to follow up on what Melody said. It really is critical, the data and system inventories. I can't tell you how many times we'll be engaged in investigation. We're conducting forensics. We identify a system has been compromised. Okay, system SYS 2016, and we ask the company, all right, let's go get it. Let's unplug it, or let's do whatever we need to do. So we go to the rack, and it's not there. Like the system, we can't find the system. So we can't find the server. So that happens. And then other things that are very common is you identify, okay, the criminals came in, got a good sense that it's Russian hackers. They made their way through the network. They own the network, but they were targeting this system. They got on this system, and they took some data out. What data, was on that system? Or we have a sense of what the purpose of that system is, or the databases behind the system, or what. And then the investigation stalls, and you spend 5 or 10 days trying to figure out. I mean, and that's just huge risk exposure. We should understand where our data is, and we should understand where our systems are on our network. So that's number one. And then number two, you mentioned the plan. So most companies that have had a security department have had some processes in place along the way, and usually have a security incident response plan that helps the technical team know what to do and how to evaluate the noisy security incidents that they see on a daily basis. What severity is it? What do we do if it's severity 2 or 3 or 4? Who do we contact? What procedures do we follow? How do we investigate from that perspective? So that's been around a little bit longer, but what hasn't been around is, since cyber is a business risk issue, it's not an IT issue anymore, what do the non-technical people do? What do your PR people do? What does your HR people do? What about your general counsel? What about your chief risk officer? What role do they have in these security incidents where immediately the issues are moving out of the technical area? I would say in responding to incidents, maybe 20 to 30% of what you're dealing with is technical, 20 to 30% maybe HR or communications, and then a whole host of what you're dealing with is legal. So do those individuals know what their roles and responsibilities are? Do they know how to communicate? Do they know how to escalate? Do they know how to identify the issues? And that's really the planning that needs to take place. No different in some ways than crisis events, earthquakes, and physical events that might happen where the business has an understanding of how to respond as an enterprise. And then, of course, you got to test it, because we as lawyers love to write things, but if it doesn't work in practice, and so much of this is crisis management driven, that if you assign a person to a role on a piece of paper that they are in charge of this, but then an actual incident happens and they are completely freaked out, they hate crisis, they're out of there, they don't want to think about it, that's not going to be effective. So test the plan, make sure it works for the company.
Let me ask you a follow-up for the lawyers in the room or the future lawyers in the room. How technical do you need to be to advise companies on cybersecurity from a legal perspective?
This one's near and dear to my heart, so I'll just launch into it. There's a great article that came out in the Post. It's called Tech Law Needs a Reboot. It was in the Washington Post Sunday article. And I don't agree wholeheartedly, because it does sort of bash on government lawyers. But it does say, too few lawyers have the skill set or specialized knowledge to make sense of code, networks, and the people who use them. And too few law schools are telling them what they need to know. I do feel strongly it's a very technical area. And in order to advise your client well, or even advise them at all, it's a new language. You need to be proficient in that language. Maybe not fluent. You don't have to be the best coder, or even maybe understand how to code. But you've got to understand systems. You have to understand what basic terms relate to, basic terms that criminals, or what criminals are doing on systems, what malware is, and obfuscation, and different algorithms and encryptions. You have to be proficient in that language. Otherwise, if you don't understand the language, you can't advise on it.
And Merritt, from the Homeland Security perspective, what do you think companies or private citizens can best do to prepare for a cyber incident?
So just, I will absolutely address that, and I think that's important. But just as a layer on what Kim mentioned, I think it's important to be technical, but you can also develop that yourself. And I also think that women have a habit of having imposter syndrome, so they think they're not good enough when they are. And I think that I've seen more in my experience incidences of women walking in and saying, I'm not a technical person, when they know a lot. So I would just caution, while Kim is totally right that every technical wherewithal you have is useful, and in fact, like, especially if you're talking about forensics or, like, if you are a cop and you show up and say, what's a house? Like, that's not helpful. But you can learn how to know the rules of the game without being the best at gaming it. And I would just give that as, like, the emperor has no clothes kind of caution against this being a barrier to entry. So, but then on the note of, so I guess, you know, as to, just like I said earlier, so I think it's really important to recognize the texture. And this is, to my mind, I mean, I'm one of those people who's so critical of America and I love it so much. You know, that's what excites me. And I think one of the things about America is that we are super innovative and we see Silicon Valley as our golden goose. And we protect it and we love our systems architects and we love, and then at the same time, we reserve the right to be like creepy in Washington and to do nothing. Like there are things that are textured, but they're not without reason. So if you're looking at game theory for who the threat actors are, let's think about what the Russians want. It's usually money. Let's think about what the Chinese want. It's usually information. Let's think about what the Koreans want. It's usually influence. Like you go through the Israelis. There are basically five threat actors that are nation state level and they are knowable. Then you go through what they want. Then you think about your networks. And I agree with everything that the ladies said about sort of thinking about, I mean, it's not a zero-sum game, but hardening and embrittlement is. So if you have your own employees that want to access without obstruction, then you have to think about how accessible you want to make your networks. You know, these are just human questions in some sense, but they are technology questions, and they're not unsolvable, and they're not zero-sum games, but they're also to be thought through in terms of what kinds of levels of access, what kinds of business you're doing. These are just, I guess to me they're common sense, but I also think it becomes a way of breathing and living that you just think about what makes sense. And in that sense, it's not that I disrespect the idea that security is important. It's more that we know that this is the world we live in. You don't walk down the street with like dollar bills flying out your purse. You walk down knowing what kind of risk you're willing to assume and you try to inform people around you about how secure you are. And part of that is just the pretense. And don't get me started on just the fact that walking down the street as a woman is a different thing. But you know, like, but that's just a fact. In some sense, you play the cards you're dealt. So I think that it's important to recognize that a lot of these technologies that we are enveloping into our lives, we are, I think it's totally true that we're not thinking through the security implications. But it's a, to me, it's a reason why we should get more involved in the architecture of the technology. Why aren't our transactions secure? Why are they kept secret? Maybe we should just sunlight them and put them on blockchain. Maybe we should have land deeds on blockchain. I'm not here to advocate, that's just an example, but like we could talk about anything. We could talk about other cutting edge, I mean, let's talk about self-driving cars. It will allow people who couldn't talk or move to get in a car. Well, what are the liabilities? What are the technology implications? It has to work 100% of the time in a lawyer's mind. In my mind, as a technologist, although I am a lawyer by training, like maybe we'd be okay with it if it worked 98% of the time. I just don't believe in percentages, but I do believe in metrics. And I think it's hard to gauge what we're doing right when we aren't looking at it with a lens that allows us to gauge what we want. And what are our values? What's important to us? What do we want to live by?
Thank you. I'd like to talk a little bit about the future of cybersecurity. To start, you know, we hear a lot about the importance of the public and private sectors working together to combat the cyber threat. Could you give us your perspective on how that's going, and where do you see the public-private partnership in cybersecurity, say, 5 years from now? Melody, do you want to start?
Sure. Maybe I'll start with an area I think there's strong alignment, and I think both the private and public sector have strong alignment that you want to disincentivize hackers from their current activity, and that right now the incentives are such that it's a highly lucrative field. It makes a lot of sense, and so I think that alignment is clearly there. The general referred to kind of the government's capability on attribution. I think that is where the government has like a real capability advantage, and that the private sector values. The government also has a monopoly right now on prosecution, and that is also something that the private sector values. So I think on that sense, there's real alignment that they should be partnering to disincentivize hackers, and there should be more done in that area. There's other areas of lack of alignment. I think the core question is, how much do you expect the government to intervene or help in the event of a cyber incident that impacts the private sector? And I don't think there's alignment at all on this point. And there's certain areas that are considered maybe more like public utilities almost, you know, where there's a common and a national imperative to actually have certain services running, which would then suggest that the government should be involved. But I don't think the norms have been established around that. For the most part, my experience with the private sector is they'd rather hands off, like they would rather take care of this themselves. So I think that's the area where there's quite a bit of discussions happening now about what the future should be around how the government and private sector should collaborate in the event of an incident that is of national impact. So I think one way this is really expressed is like in the telecom industry. Like, what do you actually expect from, should a telecom provider be entirely neutral? Should they actually have a role in filtering traffic that could reduce a hack? And there's very strong differences of opinion from a privacy standpoint and from a defensive standpoint about what the role of this private company should be. They can clearly help, but does that open up other questions that we're not comfortable with from a privacy standpoint? So I think that's the area where I would see there's the most to be gained from continued collaboration and discussion.
Trish, what do you think? How's it going? Where is it going?
I think just in general, information sharing has been a great initiative. An example is the Defense Industrial Base Network, where large defense companies come together with government and share vulnerabilities, threats, incidents, and best practices so that we can work together to stay ahead. Within commercial, there are information sharing and analysis centers, ISACs, where different groups come together. For example, I have a leadership role with the auto ISAC, where the different car companies come together and again share common vulnerabilities and threats, because they want the connected cars and the population to feel more comfortable with smart cars, and so by working together it can be more powerful. And then in the whole innovation area, the iHubs, we're seeing more and more exchange with startups, non-traditional providers, you know, really trying to harness the creative genius of those around us to, you know, address some of these most difficult problems.
Kim, I have a related question for you from the legal perspective. Regulators have, of course, become increasingly active in the cybersecurity space, looking at companies not as victims, but as gatekeepers and potentially negligent actors when they're victims of cybercrime. How do you see the regulatory landscape in cybersecurity changing in the next 5 or 10 years?
Well, that's a great question, and I think it's one that everyone is keeping their eye very closely on, because the government is somewhat fragmented. One side of the government is very much promoting voluntary cybersecurity frameworks, public-private partnerships, working with victims of cybercrime, reaching out, sharing information. DHS, DOJ, and made significant strides in that. And they also understand the tension that causes on the other side when you have regulators that start to look at companies if they are a victim of crime, also as potentially negligent or having unreasonable security in place, because that it can cause and can become quite confusing for the company on understanding how to work with what arm of government and whether to work with what arm of government. And then recently, of course, we've had the New York State Department of Financial Services issue some of the most prescriptive cybersecurity regulations that we've seen to date. And so that's causing a bit of a stir because there are questions of, well, what does that mean? Are we going to see more and more regulators do that, similar to in 2006 when California was the first to have a state data breach notification law, and then others followed suit. So what will that mean for companies trying to work with the government, some parts of the government that are promoting a collaborative approach to cybersecurity, when now a more prescriptive approach occurs?
And Merritt, what are your thoughts on the public-private partnership, where it's going in the next, say, 5 years?
So I think we're doing a lot now. I think it's hard because, as I mentioned earlier, companies prioritize their bottom line. And meanwhile, government has a role that's really unscripted here. We are trying to keep systems running. So we do a lot of information sharing. As Trish mentioned, we have a new program. We, DHS, have a program called Automated Indicator Sharing. So we're sharing specifically through technical languages, which we call STICS Taxi, which stands for stuff. Whatever, I could give them to you, but it doesn't matter. But basically, the takeaway is actually that it is scripted to take care of some considerations around privacy, that it will only have fields that matter to an indicator. And an indicator is a specific cybersecurity threat. I mean, it could be something where the IP address or some other indicator has been taken over, but in general, we try to vet it to make sure that we're not the government giving out bad information. But otherwise, we basically share freely. And because we are not in law enforcement, we are not intel, we really, this is a pioneering effort to share because it's better for all of us. Like, a lot of what we're talking about here today is stuff that everyone wants to get rid of. Hackers, botnets, you know, it's the dregs of the internet. And I think it's, you know, there have been people who have postulated a potential like web 2.0 because our web is just kind of mucked up in ways that are frustrating. But I still, you know, I work on initiatives. Even just, I think what we are talking about a lot today is elevating. So I'm working on, you know, elevating the U.S. government to make sure that every default U.S. government site is an HTTPS, that we are doing start TLS as a default, that we just default to an elevation point. But acknowledging that below that elevation point is the dregs. So that's one point. And I think we do work closely and our friends to the security community, our friends to the industry, and we have the same goals. I think on the regulator side, of course, this is a different posture. I mean, this is what I meant about the texture of the U.S. government. So, you know, you've got FTC, FCC, and they're kind of like seeing everything as a nail because they have a hammer. So I would also be scared if I were a company. I mean, like, Wyndham and other things have shown that sometimes government wants to come in. Sometimes I actually think from a consumer point of view, I think it could be healthy to have government playing some role. I'm not sure that they're doing exactly what we would all want. But again, it's like a reason why we should get up and talk about it.
So I have one more question for the panelists about the future of cybersecurity, and then we'll open it up to any questions from the audience. We hear a lot about big breaches and cyber attacks, but of course, I think bad news is what makes headlines. With the leaders we have on our panel today, I thought it would be great to hear your views on where the biggest improvements in cybersecurity have been recently, and where do you predict the biggest improvements will be going forward? And Kim, I thought we could start with
you. Sure. I mean, I think we've seen dramatic improvement in awareness of the issue, that it's not an IT issue, that it's a business risk issue, it's an enterprise risk issue. and awareness at the board level. Frankly, a lot of that happened after the Target breach was disclosed, and we saw what happened there. So boards are asking questions of, are we prepared? What is our cybersecurity posture? And we're getting that top-down effect that's occurring. This is a very complex issue. It's a very novel issue. There isn't a playbook. There isn't a silver bullet that companies can do. So there's a lot that needs to be worked out to get companies to understand or even work through what they need to do. And no one really knows right now. Because at the same time we're looking more closely at security, we also have the dramatic developments in technology that's increasing our attack surface exposure. We connect more and more systems, we connect and more devices, the more and more that surface of attack grows. So it's a challenging issue, but just that awareness at the board level, the governance around it, the activity of the business leaders, the planning, the preparedness, and understanding that that it needs to be approached as a business risk issue, and companies ultimately need to find a way to be resilient against a new way of conducting business where you're constantly under attack.
Melody?
Sure. So I think, well, first to the historic question of what improvements have been made, I think on the technology side, you have to look to things that have actually scaled the defense to have a chance against the offense. Like, this is fundamentally like an asymmetric problem right now where the offense, as was alluded to earlier, the offense clearly has the advantage. And everything we have to look for from a technology perspective is like what kind of shifts that balance and actually has some scale to give some advantage to the defense. I think looking recently, some of the things that I've seen make a big difference, like auto updates, is actually I think a huge progress, like step in the right direction. Really basic, again, it's like washing hands, hygiene measures. But there's that essentially is like when there are bugs, you should push out updates to all impacted consumers and fix it. And that's something that happens at scale, and I think Microsoft really kind of initially pushed this. I think all of us who have iPhones saw Apple actually make a change fairly recently to actually force updates, which I think is actually like the step in the right direction. I think the move to cloud is actually one of the biggest things for security in a positive way, that most companies should not be running their own data centers. It's more insecure for the most part to run your own data center. So I think the move to cloud is actually a way to really enable small businesses in particular, but really anyone who's not an expert in running a data center and whose job is not running a data center to actually be able to operate more secure infrastructure. And cloud is usually not spoken about in this way, but I do believe this to be true, that it's actually a security advantage for the vast majority of companies. And then finally, I'll talk about, I think encryption is, like the advances in encryption have made, again, are providing some benefit to the defense. And that there's the move we see for private companies and consumer companies to implement encryption more is a sign of that. So those are things like historically or like recently, I think, that have been really exciting. And like looking to the future, I think it's similarly from a tech perspective, want to look for things that actually can allow us to operate at scale and improve at scale. One idea that I'm pretty excited about is how do you even like push the burden onto the private sector and companies that are creating technology to actually have a higher burden of proof around like security by design. And a lot of companies are releasing products that actually are highly vulnerable, and they actually should be held more accountable to that. I think of Adobe as a good example. Like Adobe, when it ships, Reader, which probably most of us use, and there's been quite a few exploits like over time. If you turn off like four features in Adobe, you get rid of 98% of the vulnerabilities that have ever been found. But why Adobe doesn't ship default with those things turned off, they don't because they send back data. There's a lot of business reasons for them to want it on. But there, I think there's like the burden of proof is wrong there. So I'd like to see like a move to having like more of the burden on consumer companies to actually be able to ship products that are secure by design. That will actually have like ecosystem level impacts rather than kind of single enterprise level impacts.
It'll be interesting to see if regulators pick up on that point over time.
Yeah, clap for that. That was awesome.
Trish, what do you think?
So a lot of great security tools out there that help to identify static threats and malware and help to get them out of the system. And I think where we're really moving is more and more active monitoring and proactive threat intelligence. and also the analytical tools to help more quickly identify those threats, and more automation in how you implement your incident response plans. The need for cybersecurity talent is so acute that we really do need to figure out how to automate, you know, more and more with trusted capabilities. And just in the general area of data analytics, taking advantage of all the data that is provided by these tools and really sorting through what are the trends and again, how best to address and remediate.
Merritt?
I mean, honestly, I feel like Melody just like knocked that out of the park. I'm totally on board with everything about just putting the burden on, but in a smart way. Like, we should all be accountable to ourselves and to each other. The one thing I would say is just the idea that there's no silver bullet shouldn't be a revelation. Like, this is because it's a process. When it's a process, it doesn't get an endpoint where it's perfect. It is ongoing, and it is human, and we are the one, like, on the other end of that keyboard is another human. So, you know, it's ongoing, and it seems larger than life, and in some ways it can be. But in other ways, like, this is a man-made landscape, and we are looking at each other. And I think we should remember that. I also would say, you know, like, we have had some interesting, like, so Anne Baron DiCamillo, who will be talking here later, who's awesome, talks about the uncountables, the uncoordinatables, the need for, like, in 1999, the CVE had 9,999 entries. Because they thought that was a reasonable number of, you know, and then they updated it in 2014 or something, and it was in the millions because of mobile and the CVE is a vulnerability database that's managed by MITRE and is a public-private partnership. So these are the kinds of examples of just, I'm not saying they're unknowable problems, but more like, well, sure, you can count like, how many seconds there are in a day, but that does that give illumination into your memories? So thinking about things in terms of what matters or what resonates or what actually hurts you or helps you, and I think we're having an inflection point now where we're talking about medical, transportation, and other kinds of, and home, technologies that are going to change our lives and that will introduce new vulnerabilities, but they're also introducing new functionalities, and we need to hold companies accountable, but I also think, you know, it's exciting, and we should walk in with our eyes open and know the bargain we're driving.
So we have just a few minutes for questions. If folks want to come up to the microphone here in the middle.
Good morning. First of all, I would like to say that I think it is not by chance that 3 hours into this day, we haven't really talked about women in cyber. I think it's because we don't want to talk about women in cyber. We just want to talk about cybersecurity. I think that all of us are great and wonderful and smart and can succeed either in cybersecurity or in any other field we want to be successful in. We just need our environment to let us be successful. Many successful women get a lot of fire. They cannot take their paternity leave. They get a lot of sexist remarks in the meeting rooms. And if this environment will just let us be who we are, we will not be needing these kind of meetings. We'll just have a meeting about cybersecurity. Having said that, I do have a question. There's a great overlap between the private infrastructure and IP and national interests. So where do you think the private responsibility ends and the national responsibility begins?
That's a terrific question. I don't know who wants to start.
So I will start because I think that's actually crap. I think that we have been talking about women in cyber by being women in cyber.
Like, I mean, I try to talk about tools to succeed, but also we are all here because we care about this, and first thing you do as a woman in cyber is be good at cyber. In terms of the line of demarcation for who owns what, it depends. I think this is one of the complications of cyber, that when it's not war, it tends to be domestic, which means in cybersecurity, it's weird. So we have new interactions with companies and citizens and consumers, and those lines blur, and that's exactly what we've been talking about with industrial control systems, with like keeping the lights on. I think that it's weird when people say something like, we're already at war. Well, we're not, unless we declare war. But I think we're seeing new powers exercised, and it's making us question what kind of values we want to live by. And that's exactly the call that I would put out.
Trish, can we get your thoughts on this too? Because you and Melody, you really work at the intersection of the public and private sectors. So where do you think the lines of responsibility, you know, end for one and begin for the other?
Well, you know, I think in both domains, the private sector and the public sector are responsible for protecting their infrastructure. And we do use common infrastructure. And so, you know, often we come up with our own solutions for how to protect the, you know, prescribed networks within that infrastructure. But there always is, as I said before, an opportunity to share best practices, because we have to look at it from the entire ecosystem. And ultimately for our country, it is the national security of our country. And, you know, so I've never really given thought to the demarcation. For me, my entire career has been as a consultant to the Department of Defense. And that has been the motivation for, you know, every creative professional energy I've put into it, is how to secure, you know, help contribute to the increased security of our nation.
Yeah, it's a very tough question. We have time for just one more question, so if we could ask for just one more.
Well, thank you very much, ladies. It's been very informative. And one of the questions I have, you know, is concerning around social engineering. You know, a couple days ago, I received a call. The person identified themselves as Grace from AAA. They said, well, your AAA membership has expired. I'd like your credit card number so that I can renew your membership. Will you please give it to me, sir? I said, well, can you send me an email? No, I need your credit card number to send you an email. How do we protect the most vulnerable among us, children and seniors? I think it's a real issue. They're really targets. In this conversation about cyber, we're concerned about finance, the industrial base, which is wonderful. But I think they're real people that need protection as well, and I just don't really hear the conversation around that. One thing that I have heard proposed is a K-12 cyber curriculum. And so I'd love to hear any suggestions you may have around that particular issue.
Well, I love this question. Particularly, I think it gets to the heart of the question, is that identity is largely dead. Like, our conception of how we actually validate who we are, given that personal identifiable information is completely in the wild. And it gets to the core of how we authenticate and how we prove who we are to perform very basic services. I think if anyone who's been on united.com recently, I think has seen a fairly desperate response to this question. And one of their security questions right now is, what was your least favorite vegetable as a child? Which is a completely inane question, but I think is in a response to the fact that they can't ask what was the street that you grew up on, what's your mother's maiden name, what's your birth date, because all of those core identifying questions are on the web for sale about most of us, given how many breaches have happened at Anthem, at IRS, at OPM. So all of the core, like what you consider to be like secrets about yourself that would allow you to authenticate and prove who you are essentially completely exploited. And so the question now is, how do we actually think about identity in a new world? And so I think all of us in the most mundane way see this with our iPhone. Like, I would much rather authenticate via my thumbprint to all of my apps than enter in a password. It's also easier. So it reduces, it's one of those rare places where higher security actually reduces friction and is like a really positive benefit. So the social engineering question, I think, is really a key one. It's how we see so many breaches happen. Because of a lack of awareness, but it's also just going to get worse in that, how would you actually prove who you are in this case is a really open question. I think the new ways of proving identity, like via biometrics or otherwise, are going to be the real answer to the question. And I don't have a great answer to the education aspect of this, besides like that we should all be shouting to never give out information when someone asks for it. But yeah, for me, it's like just really this question of identity. I think we haven't like really seen the shoe drop on that. Like, what are these huge stores of personal identifiable information? How are they going to be exploited and monetized? There's an end game there that I don't think we've seen play out yet.
Thank you so much. We're out of time. Thanks to our panelists.